sad situation over there. And it just, we don't understand what God's plan is half the time. And we have to take our faith and install it in everything that we do, in the prayers that we offer. So be in prayer for those people. I don't know what we could do if that happened here. So just be in prayer. And also back on the counter by the coffee area there, there's a couple cards there for Congregant family and the separate family. Please stop and sign those if you would. I was kind of inspired with this book. Pastor John Herbert, he wrote a book entitled, If You Want to Walk on the Water, You've Got to Get Out of the Boat. And that kind of inspired me for a lot of things that I do. You have to take the step in order to make it happen. And he tells a story about getting out of the boat. And his story was about his first and only hot air ride balloon. His wife had given him the ride for a birthday present. They invited another couple to go along with them for this adventure. Early one morning, the pilot was ascending over the Cachillo Valley in Southern California. Air was crisp and clear, and they could see the entire valley from the craggy canyons all the way to the deep blue Pacific Ocean. It was majestic and awe-inspiring. But they had an experience that they had not expected, and that was fear. They had always thought the baskets under the balloon were chest high. This one came to their knees. One good lurch, of course, they all would have been overboard. So they held on with white knuckle and grim determination. After several minutes, Pastor Ortberg decided that he really should get to know the young man that was flying the balloon. Main reason, as he remembers it, was a growing realization that they had placed their lives in the hands of this pilot. And after they did that, you know, he said, I think I need to get to know this guy. So he walked over and asked him what he did for a living. He was really hoping the guy would say something like a teacher or an astronaut. He knew they were in trouble when the guy responded, dude, it's like this. Turns out the guy didn't even have a job. He mostly surfed. The reason he started flying a hot air balloon was because he had been driving around in his pickup. Having too much to drink, he got into a crash, badly injured his brother. And his brother still couldn't get around very well, so watching hot air balloons was how they passed the day. Talked to him, and the first thing that happened was his wife, Chad, flashed him one of those looks that could just about kill him. Says, you mean to me that we are 1,000 feet in the air with an unemployed surfer who just started flying hot air balloons because he got drunk and crashed his truck. And now he's not sure how to get this thing down. The pilot then said, don't be alarmed if things get a little bit choppy on the way down. I've never flown this particular balloon before. And I'm not sure how it's going to handle on the descent. Just then, the other couple that was with him, who hadn't said much during the entire trip, uttered the only words that either of them could manage to utter. Says, you're a pastor. Do something religious. So Orbeck said, I took an offering. Every day as you and I head out on this journey, on this leg of life that we call life, the fact of the matter is we only get one trip. And we long to take this trip with a spirit of adventure. But sometimes that ride can be a little unnerving. We get anxious, whether we're riding in a hot air balloon, or starting a new job with a new boss, or heading into retirement. The real issue is the dependability of the dude that's doing the flying. Can we trust the pilot? Can we confidently place our destiny in his hands? It was Helen Keller that said, life is either a daring adventure, or it's nothing at all. And those words would ring true no matter who said them. But coming from a person who lived their life like Helen Keller did, they merit special consideration. She was born blind, deaf, and unable to speak, but somehow found a way out of the darkness into the world around her. Her story is a great miracle of the 21st century. millions of people have been drawn in inspiration from her examples. When you bring it into the observation of the spiritual realm, it looks like this. A life of faith is internally a life of risk. As we go back into the Bible and take a look at the men and women who did great things for God, almost without exception, they were risk takers. They weren't afraid to lay it on the line for God and consider all of these examples. Noah built an ark. Moses led the people out of Egypt. Joshua marched around the walls of Jericho. David defeated Goliath. Elijah faced down the prophets of Baal. Esther risked everything to save her people. And Daniel refused to defile himself with the king's food. And Nehemiah led the Jews to rebuild the walls of Jericho, Jerusalem. When you read the Bible again and again, you discover that the men and women who accomplished great things for God weren't content to accept status quo. They thought that more could be done if someone would lead the way. And when no one stepped up, they themselves volunteered. When our children come to Sunday school, what stories do we tell them? The very stories that I've just mentioned to you. We tell them about the great heroes of faith. Noah, Abraham, Moses, and David, and Daniel and the rest. We talk about those brave souls who laid it all in line for God. These were people we hold up before our children. We want them to be models. We want them to follow. A life of faith is a journey with God that begins the moment we trust Christ. And it's about learning to give up control of things we never had control of in the first place. It's only right and proper that because a life of faith is inherited, a life of risk, that if you're unwilling to take a chance, that you can never discover what living by faith is all about. If you have to have all the answers before you make a decision, or you're afraid to take a step unless you know all things will work out to your advantage, faith will always be a mystery to you. So let's go water walking. Of all the stories in the New Testament that teach the truth, I know none more beloved than the story of Peter walking on the water. In Matthew 14:22-33, and no doubt you've heard this story before. Our children all know it by heart, and somehow we never grow tired of it. The background of the story is very simple. Jesus is on the northwest shore of Sea of Galilee. It's late in the day, and Jesus has just performed the miracle of feeding the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. Matthew tells the story this way. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get in the boat and go ahead of him to the other side. After he dismissed the crowd, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. It was just getting dark as the disciples began to sail across the lake when an enormous storm came up and continued most of the night, given the fact that the Sea of Galilee is nestled against the mountains. This is not unusual, but the fact that most storms come and go rather quickly. The disciples were in the boat, struggling against the wind and the rain. 9 p.m., 11 p.m., 1 a.m., 3 a.m. Still, the storm continued with no signs of letting up. After 8 or 9 exhausting hours, the disciples were stuck in the middle of the lake, dirty, drenched, chilled to the bone, weary to the point that they began to wonder if they'd ever make it back to shore alive. We pick up story in verse 25 of Matthew's story. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they cried. They cried out in fear. You see, it's kind of hard to imagine someone walking across, taking a midnight stroll across the lake in the middle of a storm. Now, we have to understand their fear. They've been rowing and rowing and rowing and getting nowhere. They can't seem to make it to shore. It's 4 or 4:30 in the morning. They're dead tired. Every muscle in their body aches. The wind howls around them, rain pelting them from every angle. They are cold, tired, waterlogged. They're grumpy, hungry, and flustered. But Jesus said to them immediately, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." Now we have to understand the force of Jesus' words here. He said to them, "It is I," which is an expression that the disciples would understand. It's a phrase from "It is I," the Greek version of God saying in Exodus that his name is I Am. Peter replied, "Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," Jesus said. Then Peter got up and out of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. At this point, Peter's not being adventurous here. It's not as if he jumped out of the boat and started walking. That would have been presumptuous and foolish. Matthew is very clear that Peter asked permission first. And if Jesus would have said no, Peter would have stayed in the boat. But Jesus didn't say no. He said, "Come." So Peter came. And when Jesus says come, you better come. When he says walk, you better walk. And in Peter's case, he was safer in the water than he was in the boat at that moment. And the smartest thing that Peter did was to get out of the boat. Once Peter was fully on the water, he turned to walk toward Jesus. And as he walked toward Jesus, his master walked toward him. Everything went fine until Peter noticed the storm around him. Remember, the storm has never stopped. And during all of this commotion, the rain has been coming down in sheets. Behind him, the little fishing boat bobs in the water. Matthew tells us that when he saw the wind and the rain, he became afraid. And for a brief moment, he forgets about Jesus and remembers who he is. He's Peter. He's a Galilean fisherman who belongs in the boat instead of being on that water. But he sees nothing but the water beneath him. And when he looks down at his feet, the water is getting deeper. His mind comes to a quick conclusion that I'm not supposed to be out here. This is impossible. And he loses his concentration on Jesus. Now in this passage, faith is described as concentration on Jesus. And I find it very helpful because we can get distracted, especially when the storms of life rage around us. It's not easy to keep your eyes on Jesus in the middle of a night or a raging storm or fear that threatens to overwhelm you. And it's not only does Jesus send us that storm, he reveals us to him in the midst of that storm. Very often, our purest visions of Christ come when the storm of life threatens to capsize our belief. What happens to Peter could happen to any of us. As he goes down in the water, he prays one of the shortest prayers in the Bible, "Lord, save me." In this case, being brief, of course, was wisdom. When you're sinking, you don't have time to pray a long prayer. If you're not quick about it, you'll drown before you get to the point. The Bible says immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him. And then his words to Peter were very important at this point. He says, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" After the Lord pulls Peter out of the water, he decides that this should be what educators call a teachable moment. While they're out on the water, Jesus shares a few things that helps Peter with his spiritual life. No doubt that Peter is muttering under his breath, "Get me back in the boat. I promise I'll never do a stuff like this again." Meanwhile, back in the boat, the other fellows are watching this whole scene, their mouths wide open, their eyes as big as saucer. They never dreamed such a thing was possible. And then we wrap up the story in verse 32-33. "And when they climbed back in the boat, the wind died down, and all those in the boat worshipped him, saying, 'Truly, you are the Son of God.'" Peter gives credit give Peter credit because he was willing to do what no one else was willing to do. Before you come down too hard on Peter for taking his eyes off of Jesus, just remember, there were 11 other guys in that boat watching this whole affair. This was about Peter walking on the water because he is the only one that had the courage to get on the boat. So when Jesus called Peter little faith, he was not rebuking Peter for attempting too much, but for trusting too little. See the difference? Jesus is not saying, Peter, you should stay in the boat. Peter did not rebuke him for getting out of the boat. To the contrary, what Jesus is really saying, Peter, if you'd have kept your eyes on me, you could have walked across the Atlantic Ocean. Fear is the opposite of faith. There are 365 fear nots in the Bible, one for every day. Now, I don't want to be the guy who's too afraid to get on a boat. I don't want to be the person that hid his talents in the ground for fear that he might lose it. I want to be the person that went for it. I'm determined to get out of my boat and believe God. Fear keeps us from truly trusting God and experiencing what God wants us to do. All the way through the Word, God encourages us to have faith over fear. Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and good. Courage. Do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will hold you up with my righteous hand. In 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but the power of love and sound mind. I know many of us are reluctant to step into unfamiliar territory for fear that we will be failing. We are afraid that we may look foolish. We fear that our commitments will be far too demanding for our lives. We fear that things won't work out. The 11 that stayed in the boat stayed there because they were afraid to get out. They didn't want to drown. All they wanted was the wind and the waves to go away. Even after Peter actually walked on the water, they still feared. If we are in the kingdom of God, are going to see God's moving in powerful ways, we need some people who are willing to overcome fear and get out of the boat.
Amen.
What about you? What is it that you would do for Jesus if you weren't afraid? What would you pray if you weren't afraid? How bold would your prayer be? Who would you talk to? What would you do? What letter would be your name? As for me, I want to live every moment fully master for Christ. And it is to do everything I can to advance the world, taking the risk based on the kingdom principles. I know staying in a boat is made comfortable and safe, but it's not what life of faith is all about. In Philippians 4:13, I can do everything through Christ who strengthens me. Now I realize that it's risky to be out on the water. And it's possible you might sink. It's more demanding out of the boat. But following Jesus sometimes means we have to get out of our safety zone. And Jesus is not always on the boat. He's out in the waves, in the storm. But it's also a lot more rewarding on the boat because you get the opportunity to discover that God can be trusted. Mm-hmm. Do you have the courage to ask Jesus to command you to come to him on the waves, out in the storm? Do you have enough faith that Jesus will sustain you and hold you up and not let you sink? that Jesus will save you? Do you believe that Jesus is your Lord and Savior? Can you hear the voice of Jesus saying, come? If you want to walk on the water, get out of the boat. Heavenly Father, grant that we might be great risk takers for the kingdom of God. Shake us loose from the security of staying in the boat. Help us to walk in the waters of faith, because we believe that Jesus will hold us up. I want to say prayers for the Cypress and the Conrad families. We grieve with them. We grieve around them. We grieve with them in our hearts. Be with us, church, as we step out into this community. Help us to be those risk takers, getting out of the boat and being the example to all around us. Help us to be God's disciples. And then we say the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God is good.